Welcome to Holy Marriage Blessing, the podcast ministry of True Parents Way. I'm Tyler Hendricks. This week our topic is interior design in the garden. I recently moved from upstate New York, from the Hudson Valley, to a town called Cary, North Carolina. And Cary, C-A-R-Y, stands for Containment Area for Retired Yankees. You know how people get here? So many people get here because their children come here. And they relocate here to be with their children. That's why I came here. And I would just make a couple of comments about this. Number one, the reason my son moved here was because he found it is the statistically, the safest town in America. And I believe that there's a relationship between the fact that there's so many three-generation families in this area and the safety and tranquility of this town. And number two, whenever people ask me, why did you move to North Carolina? And I tell them, well, I moved here to join my son to make a three-generation household. Everyone goes, that's good. That's really great. And this resonates with the principle that we are meant to live as three-generation families. And we are meant to design our homes, our dwelling places, for the family, as a place where family can really connect. Now, I'm going to be sharing words from a speech from our true father, Reverend Sun Myung-moon, entitled, The Kingdom of God on Earth and the Ideal Family. This was True Father's midnight speech given at the New Yorker Hotel on January 1st, 1977. It was the God's Day midnight speech. And at this point, I do want to introduce to new listeners who I mean by Father Moon and Mother Moon. They are Reverend Sun Myung-moon and Dr. Hak Jahan Moon, who stand as true parents, called by Jesus, led by the Holy Spirit, and Bible-based. And they have been pursuing a ministry for global unity, to make one global family for decades. True Father is in the spiritual world, in heaven. True Mother is ministering on the earth. Now, this 1977 speech, The Kingdom of God on Earth and the Ideal Family, is really a landmark speech. Father talks about love, he talks all about God, he talks about the incarnation of God in True Parents, he talks about Heavenly Mother, some amazing content, very, very revelatory to us. And at the end of the speech, what does he end up with? The amazing thing, he ends up talking about living together as a family, what he called grand, big, old familyism. Living together as a family, that means the whole purpose of the providence and the entire, nature or definition of the kingdom of God on earth is to be realized in the home, in the family, in the relationships of the family. Now, Father and Mother were opening up a new phase, let's say. This was the third seven-year course of the three seven-year courses that began at the time of the Holy Marriage Blessing till the 1968 founding of God's Day and to this point of 1974, actually 1975, the Madison Square Garden speech, the campaigns in America. But they really overlapped into the third seven-year course with the 1976 events at Yankee Stadium and Washington Monument. And these were victorious. True Father had reached America, impacted America, accomplished incredible goals in a period of less than 5 years in America. And now, Father and Mother, it was time to declare the nature of the kingdom of God on earth. It was time to start what became the home church movement, to begin to dismantle the church itself, actually, to send members, brothers and sisters, out of the churches into the homes, into the communities, to minister, to teach, that every home should be a church, a community church. But what kind of home? How do we define that home? what goes on in that home. That's what True Father is talking about in the passages we're going to read. And you're listening to Holy Marriage Blessing, the podcast ministry of True Parents Way. So toward the end of the speech, Father makes an amazing statement here. Let me read it to you, and I quote, "Even though there are many billions of people in this world, you are just like Adam and Eve, who were born in the kingdom of God in the Garden of Eden. You are like a person who was just created by God in the Garden of Eden." Can you imagine that? End of quote. That we are, in today's vocabulary, terminology, only begotten sons and daughters of God. We're just like Adam and Eve. That's what Father told to us as brothers and sisters back in 1977. Then he says, by setting this condition, you can experience your own kingdom of heaven here on earth, and you can qualify for the eternal kingdom of God in heaven. We are bringing back the Garden of Eden. We are bringing the entire world population into the Adam-type family. That's what your job is going to be. And now he continues, and he says that we should love universally. He says, when you see, I quote, when you see poor people and beggars, look at them from the viewpoint of God with parental love. Before anybody else touches them, you should go and embrace them as a member of their family. Then an amazing passage, an amazing image. Wherever we stretch out our arms to those in the world, we create a little creek flowing from the reservoir of God. God is pouring out the water of life, and the water is flowing through your creek all the way down to wherever you go. The deeper the creek you create, the more water will go through that creek. You are in a position to distribute the love of God. Now, with that having been said, with that as a foundation, he begins to talk about life in your own family, the interior design of your home in the Garden of Eden. And he addresses the sisters. He says, sisters, I want to ask you a serious question. When you get married and have a home, will you welcome your own physical parents as well as your in-laws? End of quote. Why did he ask the sisters? Something to think about. It's probably really because the brothers are so kind of brain dead. Oh yeah, we'll welcome everybody. I'm fine. Hey, Oma, make dinner for everybody. It's the sisters who are really impacted. The home is the realm of the wife. It's the realm of the wife and the mother. The father's going out and working outside. The father's inclinations, nature is to expand outward into the world. The mother's inclination and nature and responsibility as mother of children is the household, the home. So Father directed the question toward the sisters. Will you welcome your physical parents and your in-laws to your home? Continuing with Father's words. America hates in-laws. Can you love them? America today is truly hungry for parental love. You know the phenomena of hippies who run away from home. These phenomena occur because the young people don't taste love at home. End of quote. So we could ask ourselves, I could ask myself, do my children taste love at home? Or do they want to escape and go somewhere else? I know it's not so simple. It doesn't all fall upon the parents' shoulders, but actually the parents are the most important determinative element. And let's continue with Father's words. They, the young people who became hippies, are hungry for love, but they cannot taste parental love, grandparents' love, or brothers' love at home. So they run away somewhere to try to satisfy themselves. Now, some of this is providential. Father actually, in another speech, said that the phenomena of hippies, God was working through it because God was setting the environment in which young people will sacrifice everything, give up everything, even in a way, separate from everything in order to find God. You had to separate from that old world in order to find a new world. Okay. So they cannot taste parental love. They run away somewhere to try to satisfy themselves. If you welcome your own parents, and now Father's addressing the brothers and sisters in the grand ballroom, if you welcome your own parents, your own in-laws, and you serve them and love them just as you love your own true parents, then you could be a saint. Father said, you know, even just loving and serving your parents and your grandparents and your in-laws, that's sainthood. Now he goes on with a very famous, well-known passage here. Today, quote, today in America, what are the many senior citizens, grandmothers and grandfathers, doing? They are just wasting themselves in senior citizens' homes. Now, end of quote. Wasting themselves. It means, if you're wasting yourself, it means you have a tremendous potential that you're not fulfilling, that you're wasting. So what is the potential? What is the task or the mission that the grandmothers and grandfathers, the senior citizens, are supposed to be doing? What it is living with their grandchildren or near their grandchildren. It's being a part of their grandchildren's lives and their parents' lives. Everything is designed around the three great kingships. And the grandparents' kingship is the kingship of the past. We represent the legacy. And the oldest grandparent is God. We represent the legacy, the past. We also represent the original ideal, the original love. It's so important that that is in the home. So if grandmothers and grandfathers are not doing that, they are wasting themselves. They are wasting all the treasures that we have. You know, I'll speak now to those brothers and sisters of my age, and they're in your 60s or beyond. We have incredible potential to invest treasures of heart, our own life experiences. And we don't realize how valuable it is. We tend to down talk ourselves. Oh, my life wasn't so much. But when we tell our children and tell our grandchildren about it, then we realize, you know, my life was pretty cool. My life was pretty important. And we gain a lot of self-esteem. And that's a much better foundation on which to go to spirit world than thinking, oh, I just wasted my life and my life wasn't of much value. How do you discover the value in your life? It is by giving your life. And who are those who are designed to receive your life? It's the ones to whom you gave life, your children and your grandchildren. They're programmed to receive that love from you just by being yourself, just by sharing yourself. And in that process, I don't know about you, but I find that I start digging into my memories. I start digging into my experiences of my life and sharing them. And I realize that was a precious experience. And it wasn't just for me. God wanted me to have that experience so I could share it, so I could pass it on with my children and my grandchildren. As opposed to, and here's Father's description of a, you know, independent living, senior citizens, etc., assisted living situation. And, you know, forgive me, because this is Father's words. And I quote, they have a couple of friends, the sun during the day, the moon at night. Watching the sun during the day and the moon during the night, they wait for the day of death. That's a pitiful situation. Here in America, I heard a very uncomfortable report of family life. When one couple was visited by their own parents, they nagged their parents. Why didn't you call me? If you had, we could have prepared dinner for you. This may sound very kind, but actually, I said, how ridiculous. Since when do you parents have to call and make dinner reservations? If God were coming to Adam's house, would God call Adam and say, oh, I'm coming, prepare my dinner? In the sight of God, that is absolutely unacceptable. The children's home is the parents' home. The parents' home is the children's home. Here in America, when a little baby comes out of the nursery in the hospital, he or she goes right into a separate room at home. The babies seldom sleep together with their own parents. Therefore, they cannot feel the warmth of love from their parents. They are very seldom fed by their mother's milk. Not sleeping together with their parents, the children are just like pets. You should not treat your children like that. Now, of course, father, we might say, well, father is came from a, you know, a different world, the world of rural Korea 100 years ago. And that's true. And he is reflecting the ethos and the culture, the spiritual values of his rural situation in an Eastern country, far from the mainstream of civilizational advance. He's sharing the wealth that mainstream of civilizational advance has lost or is in the process of losing. But we don't want to just say, oh, it was just in Korea that it was like that. It was in China, it's in Africa, it's in India, it's in Southeast Asia. Those traditions are still there alive. It's in the Islamic world. And so we need to capture those. We need to make a space for them. We need to combine together modernity and tradition. And where it starts is in the home. Okay, let me continue with True Father's words. It is a beautiful scene when a couple of children come and want to sleep together with their father and mother. It's all right. Accept them. If there's not enough room, then sleep upside down. One head this way, one head that way. Organize a little better. The children may actually think it's uncomfortable to sleep with their big parents, but they feel good. The next morning they say, "Mommy, I want to do that again." Children must feel the temperature of their parents' bodies. You're listening to Holy Marriage Blessing, the podcast ministry of True Parents Way. I'm Tyler Hendricks. We'll be right back. So we're talking about the lifestyle of blessed families, the lifestyle of God's children as God designed it to be, the interior design of the garden in the Garden of Eden. Continuing with True Father's words, look at God's point of view. Do you think God would say, well, this is my son's room, my daughter's room, my first son's room, my second daughter's room, my baby's room? Too many bedrooms would be needed in that case. Those who set up a boundary saying, oh, nobody can bother me, no one can disturb me, create their own satanic prison, satanic fence. You have to knock out all barriers or fences from around you. From 1977 on, we are going to initiate such a movement. Now, here, Father starts talking very idealistically and in a visionary way, and in a way that actually was not practically possible at that time. But here's where I believe Father was speaking to the ages. He was speaking to the second generation, the third generation, to our descendants. And here's what he said. All the women of the Unification Church need to be trained to serve their grandparents, to satisfy them, and give them some comfort and happiness. Think of yourself. In your mind, you have been thinking, I don't like that brother. Even though he's my own brother, I don't like him so much. Or, I'm not that close with my own sister. We have to learn how to live together in human relationships. How can we serve each other? Unless you can be a harmonizing, unifying family person, you will not be admitted into the kingdom of God as a good citizen. You will not be qualified. End of quote. So we talk about, you know, the constitution of Chanelguk, being a citizen of Chanelguk. Here's what Father said is the qualification for being a citizen, is that you are a harmonizing, unifying family person. Then going back to Father's speech, he asked the brothers and sisters in the audience, those who really have a special distaste for senior citizens and older persons, grandparents and grandmothers, raise your hand, please. There are many, I'm sure, but you are too afraid to raise your hands. Those who are fond of old people and don't mind speaking to them, who want to give them some kind of comfort, raise your hands. There are many people who didn't raise their hands. What if I would assign you to a grandmother and grandfather 500 years old? Would you volunteer to serve them? The kind of person who loves older people, the older the better, would be very good because, after all, who is the oldest person in the universe? God is really the oldest grandfather. Those who love God will be in a position to love everybody younger than God. In the Garden of Eden, God's ideology was familyism. Grand, big, old familyism. End of quote. So the interior design of the garden is not a lot of bedrooms. This is a little bit of Unification Church arcana, or hearsay, you might say. But once I heard that Father said, somewhere, to someone, that children should sleep in their bedroom, the bedroom of their parents, and be in that bedroom while their parents are making love. So that seems pretty amazing to think about. And at first I think, no, it doesn't meet priority, it's not appropriate, etc. But then I thought again, when I was a kid, when I was 5-6 years old, I remember hearing, I wasn't in the same bedroom, but I heard the sounds of my parents making love. And of course, I didn't know what was going on, where these sounds were coming from. But one thing that I did feel was, it sounds good. My parents are having a good time. And it's my parents, it's my mom and dad. There's an identification of sexuality with my own parents, with my mother and my father, my mother, my father. And on the cellular level, here's what I'm experiencing. I'm hearing the sounds that they were making when I was being conceived. And spiritually, I think that has incredible ramifications. But years later, I realized that's what was going on. So let's think again about that. What is the first great landmark of self-control, self-discipline, self-dominion for little toddlers? It has to do with the sexual organs. It's being able to take off the diapers and go to the bathroom, you know, be aware of when you have to go to the bathroom. What's the next big landmark? Again, it has to do with the sexual organs. Being able to control, dominate your own sexual organs by establishing the foundation that they exist for my wife. They exist for my husband. They don't exist for me. They exist for my wife. They exist for my parents. They exist for my children. That's the next great, you know, maybe the going to the bathroom is the first step, and that is the last step of preparation for truly blessed marriage. You're listening to Holy Marriage Blessing, the podcast ministry of True Parents Way. I'm Tyler Hendricks. Our music is by Ronan Hardiman. Thank you for listening. I hope you can come back again next week. In the meantime, love God, love your neighbor, and don't give up.